Joined on the phone today by Stephen Stone, best known as the executive producer of the teen drama series Degrassi. Also, he was one of the main people behind Canada's Juno Awards for many years, and he has a book out now called Whatever It Takes, Life Lessons from Degrassi and Elsewhere in the World of Music and Television. Hey, Stephen, how you doing today?
Excellent, thank you.
Thank you so much for your time today. I really appreciate it.
Oh, wonderful.
Well, I know you've got a lot of stuff to go over here, but let's talk a bit about your book, Whatever It Takes, Life Lessons from Degrassi and Elsewhere in the World of Music and Television. It's definitely a great story. Can you tell the listeners a bit about the book?
Well, I think everybody should think about writing a book. You know, you might say, well, you know, an ordinary person, why would you write a book? But, you know, we've all got really interesting things in our lives, and you don't have to be writing about celebrities. You can be writing about the person across the street. I'll bet you've got some fascinating stories that you could be writing about. radio people always have fascinating stories. I'd love to hear some of them. But I just started writing it down, and as I was telling the stories, it really started to shape itself, and there started to be some themes that evolved, like, you know, what is success? And you know, what is the connection between dreaming something and being successful at something? And I actually, to sort of go to the punchline, and this is sort of a secret theme throughout the book, I found that failure is actually a lot of the connection between dreams and success. If you're not failing, you're not pushing the limit. And I failed a lot. And, you know, I think it makes for some good storytelling.
Well, obviously, when you do succeed, I mean, a lot of people remember the stuff you succeeded at, and the failures kind of get lost in time, I think.
That's one of the wonderful things in the entertainment world. When you do something that fails, people don't know about it. So I'm a big fan of saying, let's push the envelope and don't be afraid of failing.
Well, Stephen, of course, Degrassi, one of your big successes. Can you tell us a bit about, I guess, how you became involved in that show? I mean, that's been spanning generations now.
Well, absolutely. It was nearly 40 years ago, and we've been on the air ever since. Now, of course, it's on Netflix in 237 countries and 17 different languages. But almost 40 years ago, Linda Schuyler, who years later would become my wife, but we didn't know each other, came into my office. I was just a young lawyer, just called to the bar, and she said she had this little book called Ida Makes a Movie, and she wanted to turn it into a tiny little film, but she wanted to get the rights. And I said to her, look, the book is out of print. If we get lawyers involved, it's just going to get really complicated. Here's what I'll do. I'm not going to charge you for this. I'll give you a form for an assignment of all audiovisual rights. You go down to New York and just offer the publisher, you know, a couple $100s and see what happens. Well, I didn't hear from her for a couple of years, but it turned out she did go down to New York and she did buy the rights to that book. And that book became the first of the Kids of Degrassi Street. And when it started to become successful, a few years later, she remembered that nice young lawyer who'd given her free legal advice. And I like to think she's paid dearly for it ever since.
Yeah, that show really, maybe you don't think of it so much nowadays, but at the time, really dealt with a lot of, you know, controversial topics and things that a lot of other shows wouldn't touch around that time.
Well, remember back in the 1980s, there wasn't the internet. Google hadn't been invented. So there were lots of things that kids had no idea about, and they weren't necessarily taught in schools. So really the drive of the show was not so much the drive of 90210, which came along later and, of course, was a much bigger commercial success, and shows like that and Melrose Place and the later Beverly Hills 90210. Degrassi was always just aimed at trying to tell stories that were happening in the school. And Linda always said, if they're talking about it in the corridors, we should be talking about it on the air. And there were little topics like, you know, being afraid of your first kiss. And then, you know, extending over to much larger topics, like, abortion being, probably one of the the biggest one that caused a lot of angst when it was aired.
Yeah, most definitely. Again, Stephen Stone with us. We're talking about his book, Whatever It Takes, Life Lessons from Degrassi and Elsewhere in the World of Music and Television. You know, the show, of course, started out in Canada and, you know, made major success here in the States. I know there's probably 600 plus some episodes if you put it all together. A lot of kids that kind of just jumping in at different points of the timeline, you know, working their way backwards and working it forward. And it's definitely turned into a big franchise.
Well, and, you know, I look back over all those episodes and sometimes people say, well, what's your favorite episode? And I don't really have favorites, but I did love the episodes that came out in the early 2000s. The show had been on hiatus for a while, and we brought it back in 2001 under the name Degrassi, The Next Generation. And it really started connecting, particularly in America. And there were a number of actors then that have gone along well, the most famous of whom is the rapper, entertainer, who we always knew as Aubrey Graham, and he worked with us for 7 years on the show. But after he left us, or right at the end of his time with us, he started playing a lot of music, and we thought, hey, this guy's talented. Well, he went on and used his middle name, which was Drake, and has become one of the top entertainers in the world. And it's really been fun working with young people, telling, you know, interesting stories that go there, but being surrounded by, you know, really talented people. It's Linda and I are almost 70 years old now, but working on the show sure keeps us young.
Well, and besides that, I know you've done a lot of other things. One of the big ones I wanted to ask you about, I know you are one of the main people behind the Juno Awards. Can you tell us a little bit about how that came about?
Well, the Junos, and you may pick them up down, you know, in Minnesota, but mostly it's a Canadian thing. It's the Grammy Awards of Canada. And I was involved with them for over two decades. And you can imagine some of the things that go on behind an award show like that, a Grammy kind of show. Of course, today, I mean, Canada's got a large number of music stars, and a lot of people don't even know that they come from Canada. But over the years, when we first started out, it was quite a small show, and then we started doing things like putting it into an arena and moving the show across Canada. And now, you know, the show attracts huge audiences in Canada and has some of the biggest stars going, certainly in Canada. You know, the Drakes of this world and a whole mess of others through the years. One of the things, and you'll appreciate this completely because you're used to being on the air live, Degrassi is great because you produce your shows, and if you mess up a bit, well, you may be able to fix it up in post-production. But for a live show, there's nothing like the adrenaline of no matter what is going on wrong behind the scenes, you know, computers are exploding, people haven't shown up and they're sick, whatever happens at 8 o'clock or whenever that time is, the red light goes on and you're on the air. It's really quite a thrilling experience. And I'm sure there's things that have happened to you that you've been thinking, oh, I don't know how I can go on. I don't know how I can push the on button, but you have to push the on button.
Yeah, after a while, when stuff like that happens, you just kind of have to pretend that was part of the show and just go with it.
Exactly, yeah. And it's amazing how sometimes people do think it is part of the show.
Well, Stephen, I know... you know, as an entertainment lawyer, it's, you know, a lot of people might think you probably just deal with copyrights and, you know, hang out and do paperwork. But I mean, obviously you have done quite a bit more than that in your career. It's amazing how you were able to kind of parlay that into to the different avenues you did.
Well, as an entertainment lawyer, yeah, copyright's at the basis of it all, but you're really working with people. And I had the pleasure of being involved in the early stages of the career of some people. Katie Lang and Tom Cochran and Randy Bachman, who carried on, you know, with Bachman Turner Overdrive. And, you know, really when you're doing that, it's not just pushing a button and, you know, coming out with a contract or just trying to negotiate the best possible terms in a contract. What you're really doing is trying to learn as much as you can about the artist and what it is they really want to be doing. And it may not be as simple as saying, oh, they just want to be, you know, number one on the Billboard charts. It may be that they've got a message that they want to get out. It may be that they just want to make great music and they're not as concerned with a recording career. And you've got to take into account what they really find out, what it is they want, and then help adapt to that and negotiate the agreements and try and secure the deals that that will help them achieve that. And it's really something that in our everyday lives, it's a good question to ask ourselves. What is it that we really want? And the answer isn't always as easy as it seems. If you'll allow me to sort of ramble on a bit, you might say, oh, I'd like $1 billion and I'd like to be married to a Hollywood star or starlet. But the more you think about it and you ask, well, why do I want that? You realize how superficial some of those things can be. And, you know, probably what we really want is, you know, to have good, trusted relationships and to, you know, be somebody that people respect and to have a loving family. And, you know, when you're working with entertainers, they sometimes get the stars in their eyes. But I think it's really important to get behind what it is they really want and make sure that they're healthy, make sure that they have the relationships and don't just get caught up in the, you know, the narcissism that can be Hollywood.
Well, again, Stephen, I know the book just out. Anything else maybe in the works or anything else upcoming?
Well, we're working on a new season of Degrassi as we speak. Having this is the first book that I've written, and it's kind of a cool thing. So I think I might start, this one took 4 years to write, by the way, and I hope, people really enjoy the stories in it. And I think I might just write another one.
Excellent. Well, as you mentioned, 40 years of Degrassi and, you know, all the other things you've done in your career, definitely a book that a lot of people are going to want to pick up. And again, I thank you so much for your time today. I'm a big fan and I look forward to maybe the next book coming up soon.
Well, thank you so much, Dustin. It's been a real pleasure.
And again, that was Stephen Stone, executive producer for the Degrassi TV series and also the man behind the Juno Awards and his new book, Whatever It Takes. Life Lessons from Degrassi and Elsewhere in the World of Music and Television is available now.